Hello everyone, Reed here, and welcome to the House of Horror. Happy Duskmourne release day, and as is tradition here on channelfireball.com, I'm going to record my very first booster draft for you. So I've loaded up Magic Arena. I'm going to play a three-round traditional, that means best two out of three booster draft, and let's get to it. Why wait? So I wrote the set review, or at least half of the comprehensive set review, where I covered white, black, and green. I was really kind of effusive that green stood out to me as a really deep and appealing color. From some folks who played the early access event, I'm hearing that kind of the assertive, you know, survivor based creature attack decks are performing well, but you know, that's tends to be the case, in the early days of a new format before people have really figured out how to build the unusual archetypes. But I'm not going to be scared of anything. I'm open to drafting whatever comes here and just trying out some new stuff and having some fun. All right. So let's see. Let's get rid of this. Destroy all creatures power 3 or greater. Powerful. Unwanted Remakes, powerful. Cathartic Parting could definitely be part of that sort of green-based unusual archetype self-mill. I don't think I would take any of the commons here. So... Annabella, Restricted Office, Unwanted Meat Remake, Cathartic Parting. I guess when in doubt, just take the rare and we'll see. I don't know. The problem is I'm not exactly sure what I'm trying to do with a Destroy All Creatures Power 3 or greater card, except for, you know, presumably draft a low curve creature deck. Lionheart Glimmer. Notably, this triggers not just upon itself attacking. Oh, wow. Roaring Furnace and Steaming Sauna. That's like absurd. That looks like a bomb. Like removal spell, split card with Howling Mine, and you can get both if the game goes long enough. Problem is it doesn't pair well with my first pick, as this is kind of a blue-red-gold card, but I think I'm willing to try that. If I was trying to match with my first pick, I guess I would take Lionheart Glimmer, or like maybe just take a green removal spell or a blue control magic. But you know, honestly, I could still go white-red and just play Roaring Furnace as a removal spell, but I'm going to take that regardless. Okay, Let's Play a Game is a fun card, but that is yet a fourth color. Same with Overgrown Zealot and Wickerfolk Thresher. How about Gremlin Tamer? Whenever enchantment you control enters, and whenever you fully unlock a room, create a 1/1 red Gremlin token. I mean, that looks nice. Problem is it doesn't touch Roaring Furnace, but kind of like a signpost card coming late, and I'm trying to choose two colors among the Jeskai colors anyway, so I think I'll take Gremlin Tamer. Sort of having regrets about letting all this strong green go by. Cursed Windbreaker. When it enters, manifest dread. Then attach it to that creature. The creature is flying. I suppose that's okay. And we're looking for now enchantments and rooms, right? Nice little two drop. There's actually no standout card here. Like the only one that's clearly on theme for me is a five drop, which I'm not looking to spend a pick on this early. Could just take a kind of generic two drop. It goes with the 2/1 creature theme, or sorry, the 2-power creature theme. Am I sure I'm going to be blue? I guess white is the color that I'm sure I'm going to be, but I don't know. I'll just lock up the solid 2-drop. So here comes a pretty late control magic. So this doesn't look that great because it's one more mana than you usually expect those mind control effects to be. And then also it's a format where people might be main decking enchantment removal and just kill your 6-drop enchantment. So I could take that. I could take Don't Make a Sound. Shroud Stomper is obviously powerful, plus some more green cards going around. I don't know. I guess I'll try the control magic. Paranormal Analyst. Whenever you manifest dread, put a card you put into your graveyard this way into your hand. Wow. I mean, you don't have to trigger that many times before it's really, really strong. Although Unable to Scream is also a 1-mana enchantment. I currently have no manifest dread cards. Interesting. I guess that would be like for a blue-green deck or something. This seems like the power level outlier, the Paranormal Analyst, but Unable to Scream does seem to pair better with what I have. And yeah, I mean, sure enough, I said it at the beginning, I think green is super strong and super deep, and I'm just seeing all this green stuff go by and regretting it, but I'm not going to change gears right now. All right, target creature can't be blocked this turn, draw a card. That's pretty nice if we're doing survivors. Twist Reality is also pretty nice. Sure, Enter the Enigma. Draw two cards, create a 1/1 white glimmer. Oh, or a dual land. So second mind control, first glimmer burst, or first peculiar lighthouse. I think I like this because now I can just build kind of like a blue-white deck and tap into Roaring Furnace if needed. Though, I'll note that I haven't really seen much white besides my first pick and my third pick. So maybe at a certain point I need to consider jumping ship. Okay, Erratic Apparition is definitely nothing special. You know, in the good case scenario, it plays out as a 2/4 flying. But I guess it's the pick for me. Mountain Cycler. Maybe I could sideboard in Let's Play a Game against someone who was going wide with tokens or something. For the -1 effect. Alright, playable blue card coming late. So let's say I'm blue with either red or white or both. Okay, so solid white creature. What's this Flood Pits Drowner? 2-mana, 2/1, Flash Vigilance. Tap something, put a stun counter on it. And then, yeah, so this is like either just a really strong tempo play or it can just be full removal. So I wouldn't mind taking that. How about Vengeful Possession? Unsettling Twins, Glimmer Burst. All right, I'm going to take the Flood Pits Drowner and then, based on the texture of pack one, I could probably wheel one of these playable blue cards. Still keeping my mana nice and centered around one color. Glimmer Seeker, okay. So that's just a good card, and it does go well with the theme that I'm going for with Eerie. Second copy of Paranormal Analyst. So in a world where I was blue-green, I could be doing a really nice Manifest Dread type thing. Grand Entryway. Oh, this is super strong for Eerie because you get the room and you get the Glimmer token to trigger Eerie you know, all that many times. So I think I'm going to take that. Underwater tunnel. Yeah, I think grand entryway is better for what I'm trying to do. Scorching Dragonfire, though. So I guess this is a turning point in the draft. I'm going to take the grand entryway because I think the blue-white eerie thing is like a little bit more promising to me than a blue-red, like a blue-red no theme or a blue-red rooms deck, just because I do have the Gremlin Tamer. But I don't know. At the last minute, I ran out of time. I took grand entryway, but that could have been a Scorching Dragonfire pick there. Kind of working out here as there's no super strong red card. I guess this Most Valuable Slayer is good, but not super what I'm looking for. Instead, I'm looking at like another grand entryway or an abandoned campground. I think grand entryway is like premium for what my deck's trying to do. I think I want to take that. Oof, Meat Hook Massacre. So here's actually the blue-red signpost card. The problem is I would have to assemble the proper mana for this and have it survive, but then I could start sacrificing my grand entryways, potentially strong card. Fear of Surveillance is a playable 2-drop that triggers Eerie. Actually, Tunnel Surveyor is probably even better. Yeah, these cards that make two bodies are always great, and then going well with Eerie is a nice factor as well. The Tale of Tamiyo. Mill two cards. Sometimes draw a card. Exile any number of target instant or sorcery planeswalkers. Interesting card for sure. Glimmer Burst. I'm going to take the campground with some consideration to Scorching Dragonfire, some consideration to Glimmerverse, some consideration to Tale of Tamiyo. Boy, this is a really hard card to evaluate because I don't know off the top of my head how likely you are to get card drawing out of those early chapters, but I know the campground is going to be desirable, so let's take that. All right, another blue-red duel. Scrabbling Skull Crab. Well, that would be a cool card if I could guarantee getting multiples, but since we're already halfway through the draft and I don't have any, you know, anything in the mill theme, I'm just going to take the dual land, which, as I mentioned, is guaranteed to be helpful. Friendly Ghost is fine. Yeah, I mean, I guess just taking a fine card on color is appropriate here. Another Beastie or a Murky Sewer. Is there anything that could happen that would have me pivoting to like base blue red or I'd want to play these two Bedhead Beasties? If I get some kind of double red rare in pack three, it's probably more likely than splashing black off Murky Sewer, though I did get that black sideboard card. All right, so as predicted, I wield Twist Reality. I actually had a decent experience with this Glimmer Light at the pre-release as well. Wow, Brood Spinner coming late. I'm going to take the room. All right, we're looking for another Gremlin Tamer in pack three, just to really slam home the whole eerie thing. I don't think I'm excited about playing with Living Phone. I'm just going to take Cathartic Parting for no reason. Yeah, white has definitely not been open. Getting a late Glimmer Burst makes me happy. And a second Twist Reality. All right, so there's the second copy of Scrabbling Skull Crab, if I had gone for that. Oh, man, a little bit of a strikeout here. Like, nothing exciting in any of the Jeskai colors. I'd be looking at just taking another Enter the Enigma. Under the Skin is really the standout card here, but I haven't set myself up for any green splashes. I guess I'm just taking a really mopey Enter the Enigma. Another cursed Windbreaker. Ooh, Fear of Burning Alive is quite strong. But it is double red. So do I want to put myself in a position where I have to get double red? I think I should just take Seized from Slumber, which is a playable removal spell. Additional cost to cast a spell, sacrifice creature enchantment, or pay 2, deals 5 damage to target creature. Or Intruding Soul Rager. Tunnel Surveyor. Unable to Scream. So here's a spot where I might do like sort of a strategic gamble and take one of the red cards, hoping that with 2 useful blue cards, one of them will wheel. Whereas if I take the tunnel, no, I changed my mind. Because I think the Soul Rager is going to count in that category of like playable blue cards. But I'm just thinking like, okay, if I take a blue card, maybe someone will take the other blue card. But if I pass them all, then I'll probably get one back. But I think I have a good enough chance of getting one of the 2 playable blue cards back from that pack anyway. That's what I'm choosing to gamble on. All right, Meat Locker. Tap a creature, put 2 stun counters on it, and draw 3 cards and discard a card. So that's another decent room. Here's an eerie creature. Another removal spell, another Enter the Enigma. I don't know. I didn't really get a lot of survive. Whoa, what did I take? Oh man, I ran out of time. I auto picked a black card when there was some useful stuff for me there. So, oops, that was not good. Probably just taking the Land Cycler. Yeah, this draft didn't go that well. I think white and red were both not open, so I needed to find some combination of the Sultai colors. Like if my deck had been blue-green, I could have built something really useful. But instead I was kind of clinging to the colors that weren't flowing. At least I got blue that was open, so my deck's gonna be passable, but just not as good as the dream scenario. Sure. I do have a lot of eerie, so I guess I'll play the Scrabbling Skull Crab. A third Twist Reality or a first Vanish from Sight. Or a second Seize from Slumber. Actually, maybe that's the best. My deck is pretty bad. Just didn't really get enough payoffs for all of my enchantments and eerie stuff. Like, give me a second Gremlin Tamer. I think the deck's great, but that's just not the world we're living in. I think this was the card that I ran out of time and auto-picked Murder over it, so I guess I got that. I did not wheel one of the cards that I wanted from that other pack. So it's going to be interesting. Let's go to deck building and see what we can do. I'm going to guess I want zero mountains. I do have two rares in the Roaring in Furnace room and the Restricted Office room. Those might perform well for me. Thinking that maybe I can get away with 16 lands, given that I have a land cycler and two cantrips. Although, are these even good in my deck? Like, I'm not trying to attack with creatures very much. So maybe it's better to just play 17 lands and not play the cantrips at all. Yeah. All right, I think this is my deck. Let's play. So, am I crazy or did my opponent choose to draw there? Kind of felt like, anyway. So I can make this lose all abilities if I'm worried about getting milled. I think I'll do that. Your 0/3 becomes a 0/2. So I could actually make an enchantment at instant speed if there's a reason for me to grow this into a 2/2. I'll bite. All right, so I just need to find an answer to this fear of falling, which I can use Flood Pits Drowner to tap it and stun it. I only have two blue mana, so I think my goal here is that I want to have Don't Make a Sound and Flood Pits Drowner both available. So just coming in with the Apparition and passing. Alright, tapping and stunning the Fear of Falling, then on my turn I can shuffle it back into its owner's library. Okay, the Mind Skinner can't be blocked. If a source you control would deal damage to an opponent, prevent that damage, and they mill that many cards. What? What the heck? Just cash this into Surveil, maybe, and try to find a mountain for the Roaring Furnace. Oh, great. There's the counterspell just when I needed it. Well, I would love to draw that Seized from Slumber, but I'm gonna... I guess I'm manifesting dread anyway. There's the Flood Pits Drowner again. Oops. So at first I was thinking I was going to pass with Flood Pits Drowner, but then I realize that that's just really, really ineffective when it comes to my mana expenditure. So I'm just going to spend six to Duskmourne's Domination, the Mind Skinner. Oh, but then I'm going to lose if I take even one more hit. All right. I guess I am going to go with the Drowner after all. But I missed a damage, I guess, is the point. No, come on. At least it's legendary. That's good news for me. So can this work, please? Hooray. Now I'm milling instead of dealing damage. No. Oh, because it lost abilities. Got it. So So I just have a 7-1 7-1 generic. 7-1 vanilla. Actually, probably don't want to unlock the other room because I'm at risk of decking myself. All right, and let's pass with Counterspell open. Hopefully this can get the job done. So that would have the effect of stabilizing the ground for the opponent. Yeah, I guess I'll just counter it. All right, I'll unlock. Whew, this is a nerve-wracking matchup. So is there any way I want to go up on cards? I just want to be able to kill that 10-1 every time it shows up. All right, up to 48 cards. I don't know if that's wise. Sometimes when I face mill decks, I go a little bit up. You don't want to go crazy where you bring in weak cards or unbalance your mana ratios or anything like that. But maybe actually I'll play one mountain. Because that Roaring Furnace does seem pretty useful. My opponent has also gone up to 42 cards, and they have indeed been choosing to draw. I guess I'm cool with that. Just get my third and fourth land and curve into unlocking the aquarium. Maybe I should have put one island on top and one in the graveyard. Yeah, I think that's what I should have done in retrospect. Strong, but they did miss a land drop. Oof. Now I'm regretting putting that second island on top. Really needed the plains. All right, come on, little help off the top, please. That is some help. That is probably the single best card I could have drawn. Ooh, a 9-8 first strike. Well, I guess I have no play available to me. I'm just passing. If I ever draw planes, I should win pretty easily, but if I just draw white cards from here on in, who knows? Oh, come on. So why are you passing with open mana instead of using a slimy aquarium? I mean, my position's not strong enough. I don't think I can really afford to play around anything. Glimmer Burst. That's good. Okay. Think I'm just passing. So I can afford to get milled 10. I prepared for this eventuality by sideboarding up to 48 cards. So let's try Scavenger is unblockable, then plus two, plus four. Okay, that was a dicey first match. That planes came right on time, not a moment too soon. I'll see you for round two. Hey friends, I'm back for match number two. I snuck by to win round one against another blue-white mill deck. This hand looks, you know, nice and functional. I've already noticed counterspells being a little bit less reliable than normal because on the turn that you pass with mana open to counter something, your opponent could just spend their turn unlocking a room or turning a creature face up, something to that effect. Actually wonder, it might be specifically not wise for me to put a card in the graveyard because it could increase the rate at which my opponent levels up the veteran survivor. Because it's not just that you trigger the survival three times, it's that you have to actually have the cards exiled. All right, I think I'm just on land go, you know, for the same reason as before. Hoping the two bodies from the tunnel surveyor can help me stabilize. This card has been really impressive, Optimistic Scavenger. Thankfully for me, the two games where my opponents played it, they've been mana screwed. But yeah, like if they hit a third land and unlocked Elegant Rotunda, that's three counters distributed and suddenly my blocks are not looking so hot. Yep. So I can stun the veteran survivor. I can just make some more blockers. I can make a 3/3 manifested creature. So again, unlock the Rotunda, distribute three counters. I have no good blocks on the survivor, so I might have to chump that. A 3/3 could trade against one of these creatures. All right, I think I'm gonna go for Underwater Tunnel and then another Tunnel Surveyor. And I'll just accept that the veteran survivor can exile my graveyard, maybe grow even bigger, and I'm gonna have to answer it with one of these types of cards. All right, just got to hold the fort till I can get up to 6 mana. Whenever Annabelle attacks, deals 3 damage to me. All right. So draw 3, discard 1 uses my mana really effectively. I can I can manifest dread, but then I lose my seize from slumber. I could also just stun something if I wanted like maximum defensive capability. Yeah, I think I better just stun. Maybe not. Yeah, I better stun. So that next turn I can destroy a creature for 2 mana and I can twist reality in whatever form reality needs to be twisted. Boy, they are really having a hard time getting that third land. That's fortunate for me. Yeah, I guess that was not great for me. I'm pretty obsessed with like using my mana there, but yeah, I mean, I guess I'm supposed to just let the turn inside out go to waste and not use my mana. Oh, you play it till the end of your next turn. Okay, then all right, I'm fine with it. I'm fine with what happened. Okay, so we're just playing full defense for now. Yep. I'm gonna make a bold move here, and I'm gonna turn the crab face up, because I think my win condition here is like milling my opponent for 12 or 14 cards. Can that be right? That'd be a 1-3, which is still pretty effective. Nah, it can't be right. I think I need the stats on defense. All right, is it time to draw 3 and discard 1, or is it time to just manifest dread again? I think manifest dread again. Okay, is it time yet? All right, that's perfect because now I can unlock the diner and still have two mana open for Flood Pits Drowner. Okay, so stun Annabella, because that thing is making my life total effectively a lot lower than 10. Now we have a 3-3 attacking that could get turned face up. Feel like I want to just block with a whole bunch of stuff. All right, 5/7 Vigilance might be a plan here. So I do need to actually win the game. I can't just defend forever. I do have a creature that can become a 3/2 flyer to help me start attacking. Oh boy. All right, I've got myself a 0/2. Not looking good. Yep, that was a beating. So I'm not bad at defending myself, but I do need to actually win games. friendly ghosts actually look okay. You know, the size lines up well. And if they're planning on using restricted office against me. I actually wonder if this, if it makes sense for me to just play more than 40 cards. No, probably cutting a twist reality makes sense. My opponent has a low curve deck. Okay, let's try this. Maybe my turn to get the restricted office blowout. So it's an interesting thing, like restricted office has a symmetrical effect. So it might seem kind of logically inconsistent that both players would want restricted office against each other. But I just think that it's a powerful enough effect that when you're the one who has access to it, you can plan your game around it. You can opt in and out of casting it depending on the situation. And especially since my opponent doesn't know that I have it, it seems worthwhile. Maybe there's a world where I wind up boarding it out for game three, but we'll see. So this is really interesting because like I could see a case for blocking either of these creatures or nothing. Cause in theory I want the split skin doll around to eventually be killed by restricted office. But I also don't want to make it obvious that that's what I have. Oof. So they can play Enduring Courage next turn, which that is a 3/3 creature, but it has a scary ability even after dying. Okay, what to do? I'm actually considering just passing with Glimmer Burst mana open. Let the game develop a little bit. It's also hard for my opponent to make a big play in the face of open mana when they know I have like instant speed removal and counters and all this variety of stuff. Interesting gameplay so far. All right, so just building out, kind of going wide, picking my spot for the restricted office play. Fear of missing out. When it enters, discard, then draw. And if you've delirium, you can get extra attacks. All right, so the Enduring Courage is getting two attacks here. So, how do I want to line up blocks? Okay, let's try this. Then they're attacking again. I could trade both. And then I just don't have to cast the restricted office at all. Not a great spot for me. The Enduring Courage is just such a tough card to fight when you're playing defense. Okay, the Flood Pit Shrouner is really good here. Wow, am I really lucking out like this? Get aggressive here. So 7 mana to work with. I can unlock this. That seems like a sensible play. Wonder what they're holding in hand. I find it hard to believe it could just be all lands. Oh, maybe they have their restricted office. Yep, that makes sense. So one blocker against zero cards in hand with the Enduring Courage feels pretty safe, though, you know, famous last words. Oh, maybe these slimy aquariums should come out. That's interesting. All right, game three. So far I lost the one that I thought I was gonna win. I won the one that I thought I was gonna lose. I am gonna take out these slimy aquariums because just vanilla 3/3 is so bad against my opponent's deck. Twist Reality is also pretty bad. Maybe the Mind Control comes back. Maybe, I mean, Friendly Teddy can just trade off. Is that where I wanna be? Nah, Friendly Teddy is pretty weak. All right, both Twist Realities are in. It's 11 blue, 7 white. Can that? Yeah. No. I'll stick with 7/7. I would like this hand more if I was on the play to be able to tag my opponent's first play with Don't Make a Sound, but definitely can't complain about this one. So if they declare an attack with Savior of the Small, I'll probably just triple block. And if they want to make that trade, fine. And if they want to play a combat trick, then I have Seize from Slumber to back me up. Skip Vigilance? No, no Vigilance. All right, so that's kind of fortunate for me. Okay, so if I say Friendly Ghost is unable to scream, and I make a bunch of 2/2s and just start attacking. Whoa, that's quite a card. That reminds me of Éomer from Lord of the Rings last year. Well, I think whether this shark lives or dies is going to have a big determining factor on where how the game goes. Like if they have trapped in the screen, it's pretty bad for me. Thankfully, if they have restricted office, then we just trade. You know, that's a pretty decent outcome. All right, so now I'm trying to wait out the stun counter. Go 1/4. Okay, I really hope you don't have anything and I can trade against your clown. Okay, could be worse, could be worse. Okay, and now we're back to, I really hope they can't answer the shark. Okay, it's not too bad. No answer to the shark, so we're alive for now. I'm just gonna unlock this room and make no attack. And this is kind of the key draw step. Or if they brick and have to pass back, then suddenly I'm drawing two cards per turn. I'm in pretty good shape. But I guess I'm dead to even a single removal spell here. Single removal spell or combat trick, because... No. Okay, if I have... Yes. If they remove one blocker, then I block a 4-4 and a 2-2 and I take 7. But if they brick, they don't really have any good attacks. Oh! So they could have put me to 1. But now they can't, and I'm in pretty good shape. If the Gremlin Tamer lives, I get to make 4 creatures, 4 blockers next turn. Okay, Annabella does not have haste. She's going to pay full price to get rid of her. Four, five, six, 7 mana. I actually was going to unlock the Rotunda to put a counter on Friendly Ghost, but that could be bad if they do have the Restricted Office still in their deck. So instead, I think I'm just going to get in for 2 and play the Apparition. All right, hold one more turn. Three, six, seven, 8 blockers against 6 attackers. Everything accounted for, and I don't even know if there are red spells to give trample, but putting some extra toughness on the big stuff. All right. I think I got a bit lucky there to beat a stronger deck. Hey, I'm back. I gotta confess that game one of the previous match got me a little spooked of just running out of threats and natural decking myself. So for match number 3, I'm just gonna go with a lucky 41st card here. play Friendly Ghost. I was kind of on the fence between playing 16 or 17 lands anyway, so it's one of those things, you know, don't try it at home. I generally teach people just play 40 always, no matter what, but there are some corner cases where you can think about playing more than 40 that usually involve fear of getting decked. You know, like I sideboarded above 40 against a dedicated mill deck in the first round, but is that one of the uncommons in this set? Fear of getting decked, enchantment creature. Okay, I like this hand. I can work with this. Just bottom an island and hope to curve 2-3-4, or at least 2-3-3. Hopefully just trade the glimmer against the fear of lost teeth. Yeah, like I feel that that's good for me because I'm basically just trading half of a card, a token, for an actual full card. Sort of unmulliganed there. Surgical suite. Okay. All right, might have to just pump the brakes and start playing defense. Well, if I make a 4-4, what happens? Like, say I make a 4-4 and a 2-2, and I attack with the 4-4. Do they have any good blocks there? Or I could just do nothing and try to use Glimmer Burst. Well, show me what you've got. Oh, that's a great outcome for me, right? They spent their whole turn and it's just a trade. So whenever you gain life, I lose that much life. Got it. So remember, I still have the Rotunda to unlock. No, they did not unlock their room, so they're representing that they have an instant to play. Regardless, I'm just going to start attacking. Sure. Just going for the long run max value play of discarding a land, even though it would have, like, if I had drawn another land, my plan was that I was going to discard and use the Flood Pit Drowner to shuffle away Shepherding Spirits, but I feel like I'm okay. I'm not in a huge rush to do that. Ooh, split up. Good to know about. Yeah, I think I'm just attacking. So they're acting as though they have something valuable face down here. Do I dare wonder what their red splash is for? Seven mana to work with. All right, I'm just gonna stun your spirits and keep attacking. Didn't mean to attack with the Skull Crab. Could get me into trouble if they have a second copy of Split Up, or they get it back from their graveyard somehow. Lots of land cyclers. Probably just counter that, right? They're going to have seven cards in their library when I end my turn. Or no, I'm sorry, five cards. Beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of your library. You may play it. Okay, that's not... That's actually not that scary. So they look to be like a pretty grindy, lots of removal, long game kind of deck, small reanimation theme. Well, up a game, which is good. So how do I want to beat a grindy deck? I mean, the counter spells are good. Go down to 16 lands, 40 cards went on the draw. See how that works out. Turn one crab is a little bit of a double-edged sword where it could be really strong. You know, if it goes unanswered and I mill them for 20 cards. On the other hand, they have some reanimation, so it's a bit scary, but I think it's what I signed up for. Pretty much just looking for lands. So the island is my fourth land. The grand entryway is probably good enough. Oh, what did I do though? I should have put them in the reverse order. Oh, that was so loose. I was just thinking, like, binary, do I want it or do I not want it? I wasn't thinking about what I was actually going to spend my mana on next turn, and now it might go to waste and I might be a turn behind schedule. That's okay. I'm representing a counterspell. Hopefully my opponent gives me credit and doesn't think I'm a bonehead like I am. So pass with Glimmer Burst, unlock this, pass with Glimmer Burst, and continue representing my fake counterspell. Now I actually have a real counter spell. Guess I'll just pass with the counterspell. Like, nothing else that I can spend my mana on is really that appealing. Eventually, the goal can be to make a 3-2 piranha fly. So countering the spell to protect my crab. Ooh, I was actually going to get in with the Skull Crab, like make it a 1/4, but I remembered that my opponent does have Split Up in their deck, so if they're waiting to draw planes, I definitely don't want to tap the crab unnecessarily. So I actually, if I could rewind, what I would do is attack first with the Glimmer, then post-combat play the Piranha and pump everything up. Yeah, because my opponent had shown that they didn't want to trade 1/1 against 1/1, but once I... So I could have gotten in a free damage, but once I sort of sweetened the deal by making it a 2/2, they decided to block. Ooh, 4/3 double strike. Yikes. Well, let me take that away. Eighteen cards in library and counting. So we're not close, but, you know, maybe 3 more mills with the crab and they have to start worrying about it. Since my opponent's been mana screwed, the Don't Make a Sound is going to effectively serve as a hard counter. That thing does not have lifelink. I guess I'll just counter it regardless. Oh, and I drew another counter spell, so now I'm feeling really, really good. All right, 9 cards in library and counting. All right, so I was 3-0 with blue, white, splash, red. I did not think this deck was anything special. I thought it was the draft actually didn't go super well for me, but the games did go well, which that's a good lesson that sometimes that happens. Sometimes you have not the strongest deck at the table, but you just play well and draw well, and you know the close calls go your way, and you wind up with a good record anyway. So do not give up just because you don't have a great draft. And perhaps more importantly, there were sort of some cool things going on with that deck, some glimmers of what a really good blue-white eerie deck or even a blue-white control deck might look like in Duskmourne. I hope you enjoyed the video. I enjoyed making it for you, and we will have tons more Duskmourne content for you, both on the Channel Fireball website and here on the YouTube channel. Enjoy!